This video covers June 2022's generation and performance figures for our solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 here in the UK. I'll share our Ripple Energy wind turbine performance, our electric and gas bills for the month, and our Tesla Model 3 Renault Zoe EV usage and costs. Stay tuned! Hi, John here and welcome. June's been a busy month for us and I've some new things to share with you data-wise. I also teased you, if you saw my post on the community area of my YouTube page, that Octopus Energy have actually paid us for the month for our energy usage. So more on that in a moment. And that's not SEG, Smart Export Guarantee, or our FIT payments, feed-in tariff payments either. It's, as you'll see, later on in the video, so stay tuned for that. As always, at this point in the video, the graphic on screen shows our setup, so pause the video and review if you would like to. All our components and specifications are in the description below this video too. Let's jump straight into it and look at some new stats for the Tesla that I pulled from the Teslify website. Teslify website, as you can see, is used by many Tesla owners worldwide and provides some great stats and information about all the registered cars, as well as obviously my own vehicle. Here we go then, the top 10 Tesla vehicle names if you're interested. And I guess no surprise that Tessie being the top name across all models. Here are the top models amongst the Teslify users. The Tesla Model 3 long range being the most popular, which I'm sure will get passed by the newer Model Y very soon, as soon as the production ramps up on that. This is what's happening with the software updates across the fleet. And actually, while I record this, we are downloading 2022.20.5, which is the newest version available. So that's nice. So this screen shows the charging for my home, supercharging, and any charges whilst en route travelling. I looked at my home charging stats and the 2,503 charges at home seem way above the average of 605. However, the website records any stop-start during charging as a completed charge. And with the Zappi bouncing in and out of delivering charge on sunny days, it can easily add up to sort of 10 to 20 charges in a day, which sort of makes the total shown there a little spurious in terms of its data total. For supercharging, I'm a little above the average for the fleet on the number of charges, but it's interesting to see anyway. I'm guessing I'm above average because I have free supercharging miles, which means I use it a bit more frequently than perhaps some of the other people who have to pay for it. I don't know, I'm just guessing. This chart looks at my battery degradation and compares it against similar vehicles within the fleet data set. So from delivery of the car on the 28th of September 2019 to today, when I'm recording this, which is the 7th of July, that's what is mapped out here. We started with 311.98 miles of range, and our current range is 297.5 miles. You can see there are 52 vehicles within our current odometer reading of 22,000 miles. 8 of those vehicles have a higher range, 44 have a lower range. The average range of those 52 vehicles is 289.21 miles, so we're slightly above that. This particular table looks at the best case and worst case scenarios for the battery. So the first one is the worst case, if you like. High range from day one to lowest range, which is a 10.83% loss in range. High range to current range is a 4.64% loss over almost 3 years of ownership. This table shows all the data points that are included in the above calculations. This shows the number of charges at a given percentage of battery capacity. And if I sort the data by the completed charges column, it shows most charges are up to 80% or less. the 90% where they've got 58 charges or 58 times I've done that would be where we've had trips, long trips out. I generally keep the battery between 20 and 80% for day-to-day use. I don't get hung up on these numbers, however, it's good to see and watch the data points over time. I guess that's one of the great things about the Tesla API and the data that can be shown and captured. Oh, whilst we're on Tesla Fire, this is what I use to work out the charging for the month for my stats. 83 charges at home for 109.82 kilowatt hours added. Again, the 83 charges is misleading. If you look across, you'll see the average charging time is 31 minutes, which confirms that each on-off charge is from when the Zappi is on Eco Plus Plus on solar only mode and is counted as a charge when it clicks on and clicks off as clouds pass over the sun. The pricing shown is also incorrect as it assumes that all charging is from the grid rather than from sunshine. But anyway, I cover that in my normal spreadsheet, so we can ignore that for here. The six supercharging sessions shown in June are at six different locations. 239.48 units added, with an average charging time of 27 minutes. All charges were free due to our free supercharging miles. Here's the rest of the data on the Tesla from my spreadsheet. So 1,286 miles covered during the month of June, bringing our total mileage to 22,006 miles. Home charging cost was £1.45 for the 109.82 units, which would have all been at the 5p per unit overnight cheap rate. And that rate changes in August, so I've only got one more month at that price. 72% of our home charging was from sunshine, which worked out at 141.7 units, and 58.82 units came from the grid, which went into the Tesla and Zoe during the month. The Zoe covered 331 miles in the month and has a total mileage of 27,343 miles now. No issues or problems with either of the cars. Home charging on the Zoe came out at the same cost, actually, £1.45 for the 84.70 units added during the month. The reason for that, there was a couple that we used during the day because we needed the car. So it got charged at a slightly higher peak rate. Before I move on to the solar, I'll just cover off the eddi. The eddi heats our hot water from surplus solar. We're not big users of hot water, in fairness. There's just the two of us when we have a yearly bath, whether we need it or not. So this month we diverted 55 units of solar to heat our hot water. Total for the year is 238 units. We're running total of 1,059 units. Cost for the month would have been £3.03 to heat that water during our off-peak cheap rate of 5p. With a running savings to date of £73.55. This is our Welsh Ripple Energy wind farm output and savings for the month of June. The summer months are typically not too windy, but thankfully June we only had one day where there was no wind at all. I'm not sure how we all managed to breathe on that day. The 14th of June was not the day to go kite flying. So this chart shows the June day by day. The left hand axis is the monetary amount for each day that we were paid, and the right axis is the amount of kilowatt hours our portion of the wind turbine generated. Sounds like we've got like a sort of half a blade or something, but our percentage contribution of the overall that we have. So for June, we were paid £18.83, and that's directly credited to our Octopus Energy bill. We don't have to do anything, it automatically appears. And the timing of the monthly billing period with Octopus and the payment schedule from Ripple meant that this month we received both payments for May and June into our account. So £18.09 and £18.83, making a total of £36.92 credit received this month. Let's have a look at the solar generation for June. Oh yeah, the last month I introduced two new charts which showed the start and end of the solar day for our system, plus the peak generation for each day and the time of that occurred. And those charts proved quite popular, so I've updated them for June. This is the start and end of the solar daytimes, taken from the Tesla app. The data series shown in blue at the bottom of the chart is the start of the solar day. That's when the panels start generating. They get up early now at 20 past 5 in the morning, and that's the earliest time recorded. And I've added a trend line which helped to show the progression over time a bit easier for those particular data sets. The red data series maps the end of the solar days when the panels stop generating. The latest time in June was 20:50 or 10 minutes to 9 at night. Interesting that trend line is still going upwards slightly, even though we've passed the longest day here in the UK on the 21st of June. I'm sure next month in July we'll start to see that slowly fall. This second chart is the peak generation values for each day and the time of day that that occurs. Peak output is shown in yellow and uses the left-hand vertical axis. The time of day of peak generation is shown by the blue line, which uses the right-hand vertical axis. Days of the month are shown along the horizontal axis at the bottom, which you've probably worked out for yourselves. Our panels can peak at 6.5 units, so it's nice to see so many days that we were in the 6 units and above. June was a sunny month for us, as you'll see on the next chart. Our south-southwest facing 6.34 kilowatt arrays produced a total of 825 units for the month, a steady improvement over May's total. July is typically the last month before the totals start to dip and ramp down towards the end of the year. Not always, but typically. Our average daily solar generation was 27 units for the month, which is one unit better than April and May of this year. So how did you all get on? As always, please drop your totals and comments down below, as I like to read and respond. So thank you for doing that in advance. Split of our two arrays, our 4 kilowatt array produced 525 units and our newer 2.34 array produced 300 units. They're on the same roof aspect, which means they see the same sunshine pattern, or so I thought. Because it's sort of interesting that the older array has produced slightly more than the newer array in ratio terms. It's only a marginal amount, 22 units more versus 1 unit more on the new array. And I think this occurs in the late evening as the sun gets ready to set. The chimney breast shades a couple of the panels on the newer array for the last 15 to 20 minutes of sunlight. I suppose I could check on the app, but I just haven't bothered doing that. But I think that's probably what it is, which is why it's slightly down. And moving on, let's have a look at the Powerwall and solar to contribution of our self-power during the month. Again, these figures are taken from the Tesla app. With the solar PV and Powerwall contributions, we were 92% self-powered for the month. As ever, at this time of year, solar contribution makes up the bulk of the self-power due to the longer daylight hours and the opportunity to be self-powered from solar alone. And this leaves the battery to pick up the slack at sunset through to the following morning before the solar day starts. And we often find we have 60-70% of battery percentages left in the battery at the start of the next solar day. Let's have a look back at the month of June over the last 11 years with this particular chart. So 2022 is now our top month, just edging into first place. If you recall, the last 3 years will be with both arrays, whereas before that, it'll just be the 4 kilowatt array. We had an 88% round trip efficiency from the Powerwall for the month of June, 309 units into the battery and 273 pulled out. I did actually happen to be walking past the Powerwall during a hot day. And although the Powerwall is in shade for 99% of the day, it did have its cooling fans operating. As it was being charged up from excess solar, so it was obviously getting hot and needed to cool down a bit. So this is a little video of the cooling fans actually working. It's the first time I've heard them, to be honest. This is our day-by-day chart for the month of June. House usage shown in blue is pretty steady. and we have run the glass kiln most days during the daytime, which means it would run on surplus solar. The kilns use about 6 units of electricity to run their program, getting up to 800 degrees Celsius. We would also charge one of the cars, heat that water, and use as much solar generation as we can. The solar generation shown in yellow here is pretty consistent throughout the month, only 2 low generation days on the 5th and the 18th. We had 24 of the 30 days of solar generation above 20 units in the day, which is why we've got such a good total for the month. Not much red, which is grid usage on this chart, and not much orange, which is grid export. Let me show you the totals on this next chart for that. So house usage in blue comes in at 897.5 units for the month versus our solar total of 824.5, or 825 rounded up. Surplus was picked up from the grid of 100 units or 100.2 units from the grid, with 57.2 units going back to the grid. So let's have a look at those in a little bit more detail with this chart. So this is our average daily house usage and our average daily grid usage over the preceding months. Average daily house usage shown in blue was 30 units, a slight drop from April to May. Average daily pull from the grid shown in red was 3 units, which again is good to see, a good drop there from previous months. 57 units went back to the grid, and regulars will know I like to maximise the locally grown electricity. We don't have an export tariff in place, well, apart from the 50% deemed export, which is part of our FIT payment scheme. And I don't have any plans to change that until we start using less power during the daytime. Then, well, I'll probably think about swapping to an SEG export tariff or even going with agile export. We'll see, plenty of water to go under the bridge till we get to that. This chart shows us what we pulled from the grid, so 100 units from the grid in June. Like most of these figures, they come from the Tesla app. The actual grid usage from the smart meter is ever so slightly less, which you'll see in a minute when I talk about our electric bill, which is coming up next. So electric bill covers 30 days from the 5th of June to the 4th of July inclusive, with 98.7 units rather than 100 shown on the Tesla app. So very close, to be honest, only 1 unit out really, or 1.3. That was split between 19.2 units at peak and 79.5 off peak. The bill less the standing charge then came out at £6.97. Standing charge was £7.14. VAT, value added tax, was 71 pence, bringing a bill total of £14.83, with our average cost of electricity for the month of 7 pence, or 0.0706 if you want to be precise, per unit. Gas, again, 30 days for the same period, 5th of June to the 4th of July inclusive. No cubic metres of gas used during the month. A bill less standing charge was unsurprisingly zero. Standing charge, £7.78. Value added tax, VAT, 39 pence. So our total energy bill for June was £23. We had the following credits on our bill for the period. So Ripple energy savings of £18.58 for May's generation, paid in June, and £18.83 for June's generation, paid in June. We had an Octopus referral reward of £50. So thank you to those of you who have been using our referral code for that. That's much appreciated. So that's £50 each of us if you use it. We also had a campaign award of 23 pence, which brings us a total credit of £87.64. Take away the £23 energy bill, leaves us in credit for the month of £64.64. Which should cover July and August bills, and probably some of September's. So we'll see how that pans out. Any questions, then dive down into the comments below and I'll pick them up. Please, as always, comment, like, share, so all of these actions help get this video shown to more people on YouTube, which in turn helps my little channel grow, so thank you for that. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next video. All right, take care. Bye.